All right, what's up, and welcome to the stream. This is day 472, making Songbringer. Well, video number 472. Today I'm working on a an optimization. This kind of came to me last night. There's a real bottleneck in the world when it creates the world, which especially shows itself on Windows in debug mode. On Windows in debug mode, it takes about 20 seconds to load the game. And it's mostly due to the way it finds areas. What's up, Pro Tito? Welcome, man. How you been? So today I'm working on an idea that should speed that up quite a lot. It's mostly due to this particular function here, area. So whenever it wants to go find a certain area, it has to use find function on a map. So sometimes that means that it would have to look through half the map. It's like I forget what it is. But anyways, if I create this actually as a plain old C array, that will be a lot more faster. Boo! What's up, Zelton? Happy Halloween! So there's one thing left I have to do. I've been prepping this morning to do this optimization. And what I did first was I compacted all the Z levels. So these are actually invalid now. 186, this one too. This one even, those are all no longer valid Zs. Before there were like 500 Z. Merry Christmas to you, man. Happy Hanukkah. Happy spring equinox, man. So the next step to this is to take these areas and put them into like a plain old C array, and then make it so that V3Is or world positions can have a smarter indexing value, an ID, instead of a hash. So the way the hash works is it's just like any other kind of hashing function. This is not actually exactly like that. This just shifts up the bits for each one of the X, Y, and Z. So this is a 64-bit hash, and this is a 32-bit hash. So you can imagine if I wanted to create a plain old C array with 64-bit values, that would be like impossibly huge how big that array would be. And even at 32-bit values, that would be 4 billion different entries. 4 billion times 8 bytes each is 32 billion bytes, which is that a gigabyte? Is a billion a gigabyte? 4294967296 times 8 divided by 1024. It's that many kilobytes. Oh yeah, it's 32 gigs. Man, that'd be quite inefficient, right? If your game had to have 32 gigabytes of memory. So anyways, I got a way to make this pretty efficient, and that's to create a plain old C array with simple ID values. So I had to compact all the Z's for the world. So before there was like Z100 and Z200 and Z-300, -200, which made for like 500 different Z values. So I compacted them all this morning. So there's only like 180 or so Z values. So 180 Z values. Times, say, and then this is the other secret to it all, is like to make like a maximum area width, or for each Z level of the world, it can be 16 by 16. So 180 times 16 times 16 times 8 bytes each. That's only 368K. Actually less than that. So very, very reasonable. It's going to be much, so that'll be make a reasonably sized C array instead of using a map. And it'll be like practically instantaneous to look up rather than trying to do this areas.find. which should really, really increase the performance of the world loading speed on all platforms, but especially on Windows in debug mode, because like I said, Windows debug mode takes like 20 seconds to load the game. It's annoying. So this is going to be pretty cool. I'm glad this idea kind of came in the middle of the night last night. Like, why don't I do that? All right, so I'm just going to take a little baseline here. While I'm streaming, this is going to be a little slower. Actually, let's go make sure the world verbosity is off. We're back down to 2. How you been, Zilton? What's going on with school, man? $5.49 that time. $5.82. I think it goes a little faster if I don't look at the console. It's weird. A watched pot never boils. $5.29. $5.50. Okay, about $5.50. All right, so while I'm streaming and game show is eating up that much CPU, I'm getting about 550 milliseconds to create this world, Xanadu. So that's our baseline. If by the end of the stream, if I can get this down, that'll be a pretty awesome thing. So, first thing to do is convert areas. So starting off, areas is a map, unordered map of hash typed area. Then we have areas.clear. Why do we need this find pause? Okay. All right. So to loop over all the areas, reset map percent. Hey babe, I'm streaming.
Oh, I just took a walk.
Nice.
Jumped off my rent.
Nice, right on.
Good dog, me.
I know. Barks at me every time. So this is gonna be a little bit different how this works. But it can be a lot smarter, actually, because it can be deterministic about where each Z is going to be inside its little cache of areas and all that. So there's a lot of references to areas here. It's going to take a minute to convert all this. Let's do it. Start it off. So it's going to be area, pointer, areas. This is going to be V3I. ID equals area pointer. I want to make sure I haven't changed anything else. Good. Oops. All right. Let's do this. V3I is going to need a function for creating an ID. So let's get that compiling while we're at that. V3I.h. It's going to be some static methods. JSONs. Might as well throw it up here. Static void set min ID. So pass in a V3I position that represents the very minimum and the very maximum. And now that we have the minimum and maximum, we can get the hash, hash 32, hash VP, and then lastly, just an integer ID. Just an integer ID? Basically an integer ID, yeah. ID. Is it okay to name a function like that? Just int ID? We'll call it get it ID just in case. Const. Okay, and so that this doesn't break, I'm just gonna do that for now. Okay, so the first thing is to fix up V3I so it can use these special new IDs instead of hashes, which IDs are gonna be shorter, much more compact. All right, so let's flesh out these functions in V3I. Min ID and max ID. Set min ID. And max ID. All right, so now it's just up to making an ID function in V3I, get ID. Now it's just return X. So wait, first Z. Z times it's going to be z minus min id dot z. Times. Okay, so what is our absolute x? I guess we'll do ID size. And we'll make a static function for that. Based on the two min and maxes. So ID size dot x is absolute value of max ID dot x minus min ID dot x. So if max ID was a positive value, like say 100, and min ID was a negative value, say like negative 100, it would be 100 plus 100 or 200. That's correct. Now if it were less than 0, this were negative 100 and this were negative 200, this would be a negative 100 plus 200, which would be a range of 200 or 100. Yeah, that's correct. Okay, so it's the same thing for all these. ID size that y. It's a little too compact. Max ID dot y minus min ID dot y. ID size dot z is max ID dot z. Okay, so every time we set a min ID or a max ID, we set the ID size. Now we've got these values all kind of cached and ready to go. We can use them in this getID function. So it's z minus min ID times z dot z times actually, so ID size dot y is going to be that times ID size dot x. And this is times x times y. Okay, so z, once again, is z times id size dot z plus y, same thing. And then plus x. Okay, now I need to make sure this is working. This is like the crux of everything. What's up, Momir? Howdy, Parker. Okay, I'm gonna go to like isSane. That's a great function. Great function to check this all in anyways. isSane. Actually, before we call isSane, where does it do that? We want to set up V3I, so it's actually load settings is probably a great place to do this because load settings is called before. Yeah, here we'll do it here. Set global music volume, other settings, bloggity bloggity blah. Done with the music? Sort of for now. Yeah. It's all up on, it's on Steam, so you can play the version with that one procedural song. There's a few more things I got to do to optimize it. I have to check and make sure it still works on really, really low memory situations, like an iPad 1, for example. iPad first gen has like 128 megs of RAM. This is ridiculous, right? So I gotta make sure it works there because I think this song is like 60 megs itself. So there's ways I could optimize that. I'd have to redesign kind of how everything works, but it might be worth it to do that, at least to check it now. So I got to do some optimization and some bug checking on it. But other than that, some of the creative aspects of it too, I really would like to have a few more different drum patterns. So every single one of these procedural songs will have like a few different drum patterns it could choose. Like, so each room could have just a slightly different feel with its drums. Not really buffering less. It's just that every one of the tracks, like for example, the bass track had 12 different subtracks, all of them loaded into memory at once. And it's only using one of those at a time. So there's a way I can use this thing called a programmer sound, where you can load a certain effect into your FMOD project based on your code. And so I think that would really help optimize that so that instead of having 12 copies of every single track, it would only have one copy of each track. So that would be like way more efficient memory-wise, but would kind of be less flexible at runtime. So I wouldn't be able to change the song or change the different notes as much at runtime. I don't know. It's just something I really got to play around with and check and bug test and stuff like that. So, but yeah, so there's some creative things and there's also some technical things left to do just with the first song. But once this is all said and done, I'll have a system in place to have procedurally generated melodies and adaptive audio. And so that feels really good. And actually playing through the first dungeon now feels really excellent. Yeah, it's kind of complicated. As is everything in game development, it seems like. So we're going to set V3I min max. V3I set min ID. This is going to be V3I. Min ID is going to be 0, 0. K world min z. And then the max ID is going to be K world max width. Yes, that's it. And K world max height. And then K world max z. Okay, so now we've got all those in place. In fact, let's make sure that this is just still sane. All right, let's jump into this method. Max ID equals P. Set ID size. All right, now that we have both of those, max ID and min ID, Where are they? There they are. Wait, yeah. Min ID 00, negative 66. Max ID 16, 16, 111. That's good. Okay, so ID size dot x. It's gonna be max ID is x minus min ID is 0. So 60, it should be 16. So where's our ID size now? There it is. Cool. Now ID size dot y is gonna be 16 times 16. 256. And then the z's times x times y. So the ID size dot z. Each z is gonna be this big. Each x is that big. Is that right? Oh no, no, this is gonna produce the wrong number. This is wrong. This is just times y. Yeah, so the size of the y is 256. So to go through an entire y block, we're going to go through 16 different pointers. An entire x block is going to be 16 pointers. Okay, so that is a mistake right there. This is supposed to be just times y. Let's do that again. We got 16, next thing should be 256. And then something like 170 times 256, this should be about 43,000, 45,000, all right. So each Z level is 45,000 times like about 180. Wait, is that right? Wait, each the ID size dot Z. So wait, each Y is 256. The Z size, nah. Okay, so when we're creating the ID, we don't even need to multiply it by ID size dot Z. It's just x plus okay. This is wrong too. That needs to be times x, and this needs to be times y, and you basically never use ID size dot z. It just should be that every single one of these IDs should be less than the maximum. In fact, let's put that in for now. Assert ret is less than id size dot z. And it might be valuable to we'll just assert it. So ret should be greater than or equal to 0 and less than psi id psi dot z. All right. Let's start to see something in is sane. So we want to assert that ID is not equal to use ID. And then let's play around here a little bit. U.set. Zero, zero, negative world. K world min z. ID equals u dot get ID. Set a breakpoint there just to check that out. And let's do, oops, not negative k world min z, just world min z plus 1. We'll check that. And then we can do 0. Check that, and we can also check max z. Check that. All right, let's check these out. Make sure we got some sane values. Does Coco's 2DX support Nintendo? Not officially, no. Coco's 2DX doesn't support Xbox, Sony, any of the consoles officially, because all those companies, every single one of them, has all these really restrictive NDAs, and you know, all their SDKs are protected. You can't at all share the information. Even if you were some saint of a game developer and you created this awesome engine and it worked on Windows and worked on Mac and worked on Linux and it works on Nintendo too, you couldn't release it because of Nintendo's licensing and all that. It's the same though with Microsoft and Sony. In fact, Coco's 2DX tried to do that. Somebody from Coco's 2DX ported all of Coco's 2DX to Xbox. It all works. It all works really well. I think it even worked on PlayStation 2. And because of legal reasons, they couldn't release it. So, blah, blah. ID. All right, so what are we going to get? This V is 0, 0, negative 10. What is this ID going to be? Oh, yeah. Yep, just in the future, if that's ever a possibility for Songbringer. But what sucks is if I ever were to work on code like that, I couldn't do it live because of, once again, because of their restrictive NDAs and stuff. So the ret for this thing, z minus, ooh, this would be a lot better to debug, like this. So z is negative 10 minus the min is negative 66. Console market's kind of strange. Yeah, it is. Minus 66, positive 56. Yeah, times the ID size dot y, 14,000. Yeah, yeah, okay, we're on track. Now we're gonna be adding in ID size dot x times the y. So it's gonna be zero. And then x is going to be 0, too, so this is just going to be that. 14,336 should be fine. All right, cool. So that worked. Now u.set124, and this ID. Oh, okay, so I wanted this to be a little different. U is already 00, negative 10. I want u to just be so slightly different, like negative 9. We'll see the difference there. So our ID is 14,336. Set u to be slightly different. Assert there. Different values. Let's see what we get for this one. 14,592. Right. Cool. That fail, or that succeeded this assertion. All right. So now we got min z 00 negative 66. The ID for this should be 0. Do I ever want an ID to be 0? I probably should do 1+. What's up, Boogs? Howdy, partner. So this should come out to be 0. Z minus the min ID dot z is 0 times y. Red's 0, good. Red's totally 0. All right. So let's fix this up so it never returns 0 here. Twitch just notified you? Wow. It's going really good, man. Really, really good. Got the whole release out this weekend with the procedural audio. So that's all up on Steam. And now I'm working on this what should be a pretty sweet optimization to making the world load a lot faster. Cosplays, right on. You loved it? Right on. That's cool. Is it still summertime? No, it's already autumn here. It's a really nice time of year, though. September and October are typically really, really nice months in California. Finally moved to beta? Oh, yeah, it's been beta since February. Whoa, it was 80 degrees where you're at, Boogie? Dang, it's been kind of cold and rainy here. Oh, you mean summertime on the clock? Yeah. Yeah, our clocks are still summertime clocks or whatever. Like daylight savings, you meaning? Yeah, yeah. So let's make sure this is ret plus equals 1. Ret is always greater than 0 and less than or equal to ID size dot z. So there. Now we have an ID function, which is always going to be like less than 65,000, greater than 0. No, yep. No, it's been beta for a long time. I guess I just put that up there just for the future, just in case anybody's ever referencing that video later, you know, and they're like, oh, this is the beta version, not the final version. Oh, you guys did this weekend? Oh, wow. Next month, I mean this week. What's up, salad dogs? When is our daylight? Do we change next weekend? Who knows? Somebody knows. I don't know, but somebody's got to know. So the ID should be, yeah, it's plus one now. That succeeded there. And this ID should now be one. Cool. It's this Saturday. Oh, crazy. It's about to get darker here. Okay, that's kind of cool that we're almost the same, Europe and North America here. Some of our states don't even have it, though. Like, Arizona never changes its time. I think they're pretty smart. Like, that's nice. Why do we even still change the time? Oh, yeah. Your clocks all change. Oh, man, it's going to be a big week. We got election week next Monday or something. Next Tuesday. I got to read up. See how I'm going to vote. No to Big Soda. Down with Big Soda. Down with the chemical companies. Down with pharmaceuticals. Maybe I should just mess it all up and vote for all those things. Like, oh yeah, more chemicals. Arizona, are they the only ones that don't change? You just keep your hands off my soda. All right, so this one should be slightly different. The ID was one here, and it should be 257. You don't say it. Yeah, 257. Okay, cool. And now this ID for 000 is gonna be something bigger. 16,000 about. U.S. states and territories. Hawaii, Samoa, Guam, Puerto Rico, and the Virgin Islands. Some parts of Indiana. Oh, in the past. So basically, as far as the contiguous 48, Arizona's the only one. All chemicals should be banned. No one can have any matter. That's right, not even hydrogen. As long as your protons have no neutrons and no electrons, is that okay? Can I just have a single proton? That's all I want, man. I've been asking for that for Christmas for like years. Never got it. I'm a sad boy. All right, this looks good. We got everything in place to do this new system with the should be wicked faster. The ID here for world maxi is going to be something close to the maximum value. Oh, I didn't like that. Oh, what? I didn't like this one. Oh, because the world maxi. Oh, we need to do plus one in the ID check. Down with oxygen. Neutrons only. Ugh. Man, see, this Christmas, I'm not going to get it either. Oxygen does kill us. Isn't that funny? So ironic. Oxygenation. So the ID size dot Z is the max ID size dot Z minus the min ID size dot Z plus one. Seems kind of wrong, but or is it? Is that right? Does it matter? Okay, that time it didn't fail, of course, but is that right? So if the max is like 111. Yeah, we want this to be plus one. We want to have one extra Z. So bye. All right, Boogeyman. See you, dude. Halloween party? We're having one right now. This is the Halloween party. You guys aren't dressed up? I'm dressed up. You can't tell who I am? All right, so we got all this ready to go. All right, the next step in this little evolution of it all. Actually, let's check in so far. Max, min, ID size, get ID. Little Red Riding Hood, you got me. Elmo, even better. Oh, Elmo. Man, it reminds me of this one Elmo doll that my girl and I found in a bush one time. And it was just sitting there in a bush talking. Seriously, there was an Elmo doll in the bushes, constantly talking. We never actually identified it. We never actually went and found it and saw it. But there was an Elmo doll in the bushes talking at us for a good 15 minutes. It was crazy weird. Funny memory. So we got these sanity checks. Did I eat a cactus? No, I ate a cactus later that night. This was before that. Which is weird, right? How do weird things happen right before you're about to do weird things? Why does that always happen? Right? Shouldn't the weird things be happening during the weirdness? It's like the world's like, oh, this guy's about to do something weird. Let's make shit really weird for him. Before he does anything weird. So it seems even weirder. Alright, good. All right, here we go. We're jumping off the edge. We're jumping into the cold. This could be cold water. It could be warm water. We're doing this. We're doing a plain old sea array rather than a map to make this all way faster. Wait. Weird. It's weird that weird things happen before you're weird. It's so weird. Okay, area's not clear. This is going to be if areas, first of all, hold on, world info. Areas starts as null. If areas is not equal to null, delete areas. Areas equals null. Okay, get things started here. Ooh, wait, one more thing here. Blocks has this other, this numz. Let's call that K world num z. and throw this into constants so world can use this too. So world maxi, minzy, and numsy. Get that compiling. All right, so now we can use that when we create our areas. Where were we gonna create our areas? Before, I guess it would be area guaranteed. So we'll say if areas equals, whoops, if world.areas equals null pointer, world.areas equals new area pointer. Wait, I'm not doing this right. New area pointer, k world numz. Did I do that right? I think it's right. There we go. Auto will locate this. Now, area is going to have to be smart, so got to go auto id equals world.pause.getID. If areas equals null pointer, or the ID is less than or equal to 0, or the ID I already asserted this. Why am I checking this twice? I guess it would be nice to have an isValidID function. Yeah, because that way release code cannot fail. Hardening the release code, very good idea, always. V3i.h, let's do this. Set min ID, set max ID, static, bool, is valid ID. E3i CPP. Bool V3i is valid ID. Int ID. And it's the same thing as this. Return ID is greater than 0. Zelda D-Ret. Okay, so now we can check it. If Arias is null, or it's an invalid ID. Then we return blank area. Otherwise, we can crack into our new world.areas. Or wait, this is world.areas. So our area pointer is gonna be world.areas. ID minus one. It just hit you? You should have dressed as Rock for the stream. Or as Jim. It's Jim. I would have been the first guy to cosplay as Rock. Man. If only I had a good top hat. And I'd have to shave my beard off. I'd have to get in better shape and have a big old sword. And some awesome pants. It's possible though. Oh, and some orange like visor glasses. No problem, dude. Oh, it's an easy thing to dress as if you're a white guy, like me. Okay, now we've got this. If the pointer's null, we return blank area. Otherwise, we just dereference the pointer. Blaggity blam. What? Welcome, Ken Felling. Okay, so now this function should be okay. This first one. Good. All right, let's turn this into a pound define so that I can reuse this here. Auto ID equals pause.getID. Pointer world areas ID minus one. Return pointer equals, oh. Let's call this return area. Return pointer equals null, blank area, otherwise indirection pointer. All right, there we go. I guess there's really no need to make that a underscore. Return area world.pause. There. Now we don't have any duplicate code. And here we return area P. Blam! Okay, now we're down. We've got two functions finished here. If you're just tuned into today's stream, what's going on here is I'm working on optimizing the loading time of the game, which has a lot to do with the way it generates the world. This is a procedurally generated world. It generates the world every time you load the game. It typically loads the game, or creates the world basically, and loads the game in about half a second. But on Windows, in debug mode, it takes like 20 seconds. It's ridiculously slow because of the like pointer checks and stuff like that they have in debug mode. And this is basically going to make all of that loading way faster because the bottleneck is mostly in how it finds different areas. There's like, you know, maybe like 1,000 or so different areas, the rooms, 1,000 or so different rooms you could think of in this game. And so how to find that the fastest way. Right now, or before, I was using a map, and a map has, you know, typically pretty good lookup speeds, but nothing beats a pure C array. So I'm using a pure C array now, which is a little bit trickier. Got to be careful about your pointers and stuff. But this should pay off in a huge performance increase. At least I'm hoping it does. All right, so this is world.areas p.hash. All right, I need to write this a little bit more flexible now so that I can use this for this too. Dang, all right, that means. Okay, I'm starting to think about how this could be written better. We at least need to pass it an ID variable. Speaking of C arrays, the other day I wrote a dynamically located C array library, which grew out of needing and maintain and sort of list of sprites, Really? Nice. So how does it relocate? What happens when you want to do one more element beyond the end of the array? Is it just make a new one, copy everything, and then delete the old one? Oh, this is gonna be way better. If I just pass in the ID to start with, world.pause.getID, or actually it should be like this, auto ID. And this should be, well, it's already there like that, but that should be like that. Oh, but it uses your custom allocator. Dang, that's badass, man. You're writing a kick-ass system from the ground up. Ah, I bet that's so satisfying. You implemented relock. Oh, and it doubles in size. Good move. I bet that's a really efficient. Awesome. So pointer equals world.areas equals null pointer or not valid ID. Null pointer. Getting shorter. Your favorite part is sorting, though. To merge sort, it takes a function pointer for a custom comparison function. Nice. Function pointer too. That seems really nice and efficient too. Rather than standard function, you know. Function pointer for the win, man. Oh, we need one more. There we go. Okay, I think I can boil this down to two different defines. Define get area pointer from an ID is just like that. And let's be pragmatic. All right, so if world areas is null, or this is not a valid ID, this returns null pointer. Otherwise, it returns world areas ID minus one. Cool. So get area ID I don't even want get area dot ID anymore. I want to do this in here. So return Sacrifice the memory for the sake of speed. All right, this is good enough. Okay, so this should work so far. Yeah, so these three functions should be okay. We want to set a breakpoint though right here to make sure this works. Oh wow, at least one sort per frame. Okay, so now the rest of these functions need to get written. Is clear is going to be world.areas equals null. Now find pause. We're going to loop over every single area and see if the area pause hash is equal to that hash. Kind of inefficient, but oh well. Oh, there you go. Function pointer. Oh, the black screen. All right, I need to change this up a little bit. V3I. I'm thinking. Sync in the ID types. Let's type def it. Nice, it draws for one frame. Yes. Ah, that's awesome. That makes me think of this problem I had yesterday. It wasn't playing audio for certain sound effects, like stereo sound effects, and it was on Windows only. It was a crazy bug to find. But I finally found out that it was playing sound effects as long as there were at least two of them. So if there was one lonely stereo sound effect, it would be silent. And it was only when this other silent, other sound effect came in for like just a blip of a second, like 0.1 seconds. It played the really, really quick audio. I was like, oh, it's playing barely right there. Same kind of thing. One frame of audio, practically. It was a moment of enlightenment. Now we don't need to check if I is greater than zero. Well, yeah, it does have to be greater than zero. And less than Z. It's nice when you notice. Yeah, it does. What was the reason? I don't know. I guess I'm chalking it up to a bug in FMod. I still have to email the guys at FMod about it. But yeah, it was Windows only, stereo sound effects only, and it was only if they were the solitary single sound effect playing. So if there were two or more sound effects playing, it would be totally fine. So what I ended up doing is I made a tiny silent sound effect and just looped it forever. So There's always this one sound effect playing in stereo that's silent, completely silent, but it enables all the sound effects to work because of that. It's just a workaround. It's a workaround. It's tough when you're doing stuff like that and you're using somebody else's engine. You know, you don't really know. You don't have any control over recompiling their engine, so the only thing you can do is work around, which is a really nice thing about what you're doing, Solid Dongs. Writing your whole engine from the ground up and doing it all yourself. You have complete control over that kind of stuff. If there's bugs, you can totally handle it. You don't have to work around it, which is awesome. And you can go where just for raw performance everywhere you go. I really respect that, man. Is FMod open source? It kind of is. It's like, no, it's not. Yeah, it's commercial, but it's like, it has a really friendly indie license, but it's not technically open source, no. I think if you do have an indie license with them or any kind of commercial license or whatever, I think you can technically get their source code somehow. Maybe by just emailing them or something. But you have to have a license with them first. And while I do technically have an indie license with them, I haven't requested the source code yet, I guess. Yeah, you got aggravated about Unity. Yeah. Yep, that's why I don't use it. But, well, one of the reasons why I don't use it, but mostly because it's software. Right? Isn't that ironic? Throw all this ID stuff all in the same place. Make that a little friendlier to work with later. Right. Instead of wondering whether it's in your code or someone else's code or, yeah. Okay, now we have a V3I ID type, which is unsigned, and we can get the maximum value for it. So that. Actually, oh man. Nah, I'm probably going to want to be able to get the X, the Y, and the Z. Yeah, you won't, dude. You'll have a totally solid code base. Okay, dang it. I got to do this one more time. One more thing. Oh, you know what? This would be simpler too if this were called set ID size. This was min and max. I keep changing this. Set ID size, get ID size, and is valid ID. Okay. One more change. Whoops. And yeah, I changed my mind. I'm turning this back into a V3I. ID size. Right, the buffers pushing things, pop, like use this buffer, use these values, do this. IO kit, really? What's IO kit for exactly again? There we go. Now we don't need to store min and max. Oh, we do. So this is going to be V3I cons ref. Oh, for HID devices. Oh. Okay. I wonder if OIS uses that. All right, good. Now, one of the first errors we'll have is in game when we're setting it up. There's no more min ID, max ID. It's just going to be set ID size. Yeah, for the most part, they are Objective-C. I think, are some of them C? I think they have some lower level C libraries. They're probably starting to write things in Swift these days, too. I don't know. All right, good. All right, we're good. Oh, yes. So we want the ID size from V3I, get ID size. So I is going to be less than, no, actually I is going to be 1. And I is less than ID size dot Z. So we're literally going looping over every single area. Mm-hmm. Lower levels all C. Mm-hmm. So the pointer is going to be get area pointer for ID I. Now if pointer not equal to null and pointer, let's just call that A. If A is not equal to null and A area pause dot hash equals hash, return A area pause. That was a long process, but there, we finally have the first function written to search through all of the areas now. Hmm. Okay, get random pause. Get a completely random position in all of the areas. When do I ever use this function? Get random pause. Flux. Oh, it's when you're cycling areas. That's kind of cool. All right. All right, let's do, we're gonna get the ID size. And then we're gonna loop. We'll get a starting ID. Drand. The modulus is going to be id size dot z plus one. So we loop from I equal, well, we don't set I to start with. I guess this could return an invalid pause. Oh, yeah, that's fine if that returns an invalid pause. Okay. So we're going to loop through all the world, we want to get the current, every one of these, we want to get the current area. If it's not null, then return it. That's all there is to it. Return a area pause. There we go. There. So that basically chooses an area at random and keeps looping for a little while, if it's a null pointer. So we get the ID size, we choose a random index into all of our huge array list, or area list. And I can actually be less than or equal to ID size dot z. Same thing here. Okay. Okay, get random pause for a certain Z. This is going to be a little trickier. Man, I hope all these functions work. It's going to be a lot of testing tonight. But, oh, man, I didn't think this would take an entire day, but it looks like it's going to. But hopefully this works and this makes things a lot faster. So we got the ID size. We're going to need that. We want to randomly choose between, so I is gonna be ID size dot Y. pointers seem to be highly discouraged, really? That's what they always say. Oh, and this I is supposed to be 1+. Is it illegal? I don't think it is. It depends on your state, I'm sure, but at least here in California, cops are always catching people for fireworks. There's a lot of weird things that are illegal. Like, I didn't know you couldn't have roosters in the city, but here in California, at least, you can't have roosters, man. That's illegal. If you got a rooster, you go to jail. Oh, it's legal there? Whoa. In Germany, only on the New Year. That's good, man. That's good for the environment. Oh, wow. Such a difference. Whoa, they're right on the border. Yeah, that's normally when we do them. 4th of July. Mostly 4th of July. So we want to get the area pointer. Okay, we want 1 plus z times. Oh, this would be so much better if I just created a V3I. Okay, V3I position. The position is. Position min, we'll call it, this is a position minimum. It's 0, 0, z. So the ID is going to be min.getID plus drand id.size.y plus 1. There we go. Yeah, there, it's so cold, right? You can't wear gloves because how else are you supposed to light the lighter? Or the matches. I is less than or equal to ID size. This is going to be min.getID Actually, this should be. Main ID, man, this is getting complicated. It's so much more complicated to do this this way, but it should pay off. Just light the gloves on fire. Dry's code, what's up, man? This is C++. Alright, min ID plus ID size dot Y. Yes, I think that's right. Man, it's really complicated and long to do it this way, but there we go. Now we have a random position inside a Z value. Okay, all right, moving on. We got 20 more. Dude, it's gonna take forever. 13 more, all right, it's only 13 more. Reset Z, so we wanna go through every single position. This is almost the same thing right here. Okay, it'd probably be best if I went and made a for loop that's really friendly for this, because I'm going to have a lot of these kind of functions that are like this for a certain Z. So let's do that. We would get the ID size. Yeah. Okay, so this is gonna be something like this. Like, define for each Z. No, for each ID given a Z. Simplify this. Simplify. So do we even need the ID size? So not really. If we're gonna do a min. So for auto min equals v3i 00z dot get ID. Max is v3i. Zero zero z plus one. Oh, that's going to fail for. Damn it. I guess I need to take off the assertion. Because this is going to be too handy to just go plus Z plus one and then minus one. Okay, for all that. For each of those, we have an I equals min. I is less than or equal to max plus plus I. Man. Where did I put that other define? There we go. Get area pointer for each ID. Z. Put these up somewhere obvious. There we go. Okay. So that's, this is all going to need to be debugged, but I think this is proper. We start with the min of the 0, 0, the current z.getID. The max is 0, 0, the z plus 1 minus getID of minus 1. I starts at min. I is less than or equal to max. Yeah, because this is minus 1. And then plus plus I. Okay. Now, get random pause. This is going to be so much easier. I mean, this get random pause. We're going to go for each ID Z. We don't need to worry about any of this. There we go. And then same thing for functions like this. Man, this is going to be way easier. Actually, we could do a for loop as well. We could do for each area pointer. No. That's ridiculous. Ridiculous. Okay, reset Z for each ID Z. If A is not equal to null pointer, we already know it's part of the Z, so we can just reset it. If A is not equal to null, A reset. Okay, this is getting easier. Now that I've got this nice define macro here. Where's the rest of the errors at? Twelve more to go. Get map percent. This is looping over every single area. So it's like get random pause. We get the ID size. Okay, similarly, this would be so much better if I just did for all Z. Or, oh, this would be so much better this way. If I choose a random Z and then use get random pause. So much better. All right. Let's do that. Return world. Get random pause for K world min Z plus D rand. K world num Z. Yes, so much simpler. World get random pause. Min Z plus DRAM might be zero. So yeah, that would be right. And then world number of Z. Actually, this needs to be plus one. So we're doing DRAM, which is modulus. Okay. Much better, much better. Not duplicating any code, no more coupling there. The last thing I need here is for each ID Z, we also want to do for each, like for all IDs. All right, so the minimum is 0, 0, K world min Z dot get ID. This should actually be just one. And then the maximum is going to be 0, 0 K world max Z plus one get ID minus one. That should be for all IDs. All right. Now we got two. These are now with these handy methods and that, I mean, all three of these handy macros. The rest of this code should be pretty easy to write. So this is, we're looping over all areas. So we're just going to go for all IDs. It's not complete. It's a milestone, right? The milestone that I've achieved so far is just procedurally generated melodies and adaptive audio for the first dungeon. My next steps are I've got to make sure it works on low memory systems. Like an iPad 1, for example, has only 128 megs of RAM. Can you believe that? And if I want to support iPad 1, I've got to make sure that the music works that way. And I'm pretty sure it won't work right now because each song, if it's procedural the way I read it right now, is like each song is like 60 megs because it has to load 12 tracks for every single track. Right, so that just takes like, you know, even with compressed audio, even streaming compressed audio, you know, it would be kind of a, I guess streaming compressed audio might work. I don't know, I'll have to play around with it. So there's some technical things and there's also some creative aspects too. Like creatively, I'd still like it to be able to play different notes in each room. And while it can do that, there's some limitations in FMOD, which make it sound really bad. No, I wouldn't have to fall back to non-proc gen audio. I could either use streaming samples or I could use compressed samples that in memory. So it doesn't uncompress the samples into memory. Or I could use what are called programmer sounds. So I would shoot, instead of having all 12 samples for each track loaded, I would only have one sample loaded per track. So yeah, there's a lot of different ways to make it better and still make it procedurally generated. Oh, you're right about that on iPad 1. It's still not that fast of a device. Good point. So yeah, it's going to require some testing. Some technical things, but also some creative things. Creatively, I'd like to like it so it could have random drum patterns. So it kind of would be procedural rhythm. But no, not really. It would really just be more like I just wrote three different rhythms and it chose between them or something like that. Yeah, still some work to do. Still some work to do there. But once all that work's done, I'll have a really good system in place to be able to write the next procedural song. So level two will just be so much easier than it was to write level one. Same thing with the overworld's music and other tracks and stuff. Once the system's in place, should be pretty easy from then on out. Yeah, it does. H.264. Oh yeah, it ought to, right? All right, if A is null, continue. Otherwise, A ain't null, so we can go A area pause here and A area pause there. One more down, 10 to go. 11 to go. Am I gonna be able to finish this by the end of today's stream? I've been like coding a lot already. It's already 2 hours, but I'm so close. I'm gonna keep streaming, even though I'm tired and my voice is almost raw. Okay, so this is once again, we're looping over all areas. This is for a certain Z though, so we can do this so much more efficiently. Get start pause and C. So this is for each ID given Z. We do want to be able to get the area pointer though. A equals get area pointer. What's up, mine robber? Okay, so that's if A is not equal to null, and A, well, we don't need to check it's Z anymore. That's cool. If has bits. A flags entrance return area pause. This is the get start pause. This is going to be a lot more efficient now. A lot more efficient. Okay, 10 more to go, 9 more to go. Get unexplored map pause. This is also based on a Z. You have to check its Z. So great, this is going to be way more efficient for each ID given center.z. You made a Lua script for the powder toy? What's the powder toy? Auto A equals get area pointer. I if A equals null, continue. P is going to be A area pause. It's a physics sandbox game. Sweet, nice. Yes, definitely go ahead and post your link, man. Absolutely, go right ahead. All right, so if A flags has secret and this is a secret level area, we don't want to count that. Okay, good. One more down. All right, so we're going to go get entrance pause from Z to Z. So we only are going to loop over the current Z. Oh, if A is not null and A A-flags. Oh my god, I just realized something really important. Filthy Frank. So what am I doing? I'm working on an optimization to the game engine here for Songbringer. Sorry, I can't show you the game right now because I'm right in the middle of this huge kind of refactor. But to keep it kind of short, there's a bottleneck in how it's a procedurally generated game. It generates the entire world every time you load the game. It's typically pretty quick. It's like about a half second it generates the entire world. But it could be faster, especially on Windows in debug mode. It's just like super slow. So normally it's like half a second, but on Windows in debug mode, it's like 20 seconds. So I'm trying to fix the bottleneck, which is the way it looks up different rooms, different areas of the world. And it used to do that with a map, and maps are kind of slow compared to pure C arrays. So I'm using a pure C array now. And it's a little bit of work to get it all working, and some debugging and some testing to make sure it's all working correctly and not overwriting memory and all that kind of stuff. But once it's all said and done, it should be a lot faster. It should be a good optimization. Turn A, area pause. There we go. Okay, same thing here. Almost there. Wow, this is like this only took 2 hours to refactor. It's not that long, I guess. Find flag. So it loops over everything in the current Z. Gets area pointer. Oh, get area. Oh, that's what I was thinking. This is pretty damn important. This function called area guaranteed. I don't think I was even creating the areas. Yeah, I was not. Okay, so we need to create the area. This is like auto create areas array. Auto create area. We have pointers null. Then pointer equals new area. Which means when I clear all the areas, I've got to loop over every single area and delete them all. Pointer equals new area and world.areas ID minus one equals pointer. And then pointer validate. Return indirection pointer. We just call this A from now on. And lastly, pretty importantly, we need to make sure when we clear out the world, It loops over every single one of the areas and deletes everything. I won! Yes! Oh, I'm so lucky! How come I always win the most amount of points? I don't even need points. This is gonna be for each for all IDs. Auto A equals get area pointer. I. If A is not equal to null, delete A. Then delete areas, and then set areas to null. Okay, there. Now we've cleaned up properly. What's wrong? Why doesn't it like this? Why doesn't it like this? Did the stream stop? Did it? Hello? It looks okay. Okay, this is using its the Okay, there's only a few more functions to rewrite now. This is kind of most important. We'll throw this at the top. All right. 7 more to go. Okay, this is a loop over the Z's. Yeah, man, this is all gonna be a lot faster than it was. Like a lot of the basic parts of this whole game engine. Look up areas, looping over all the areas. This happens a lot in the game, especially when it's first creating the whole world. So this is going to be so much more efficient. Hopefully we'll make things just be a little bit snappier. Get teleport destinations. This loops over every single area. And looks for any refills. Okay, so that's for all IDs. If this area has the refill flag, and we've explored to this map position, then we can push back this map position into these teleport destinations. All right, next function, get doors. World get doors. Oh, this loops over every single area. For all IDs. Okay, this one's a Z. This one's not here. For each ID. A is not equal to null. A get door. Type locked, said door type unlocked. This is unlocking all the doors for a current Z or for a Z level. Okay, restoring tiles. That one's done. There's another for each Z. Was that it? Oh my god, I'm finally finished. Oh, alright, so here comes the moment of truth. I'm about to run this and see if it crashes. If it doesn't crash and it just runs the game, that will be very surprising, but it might actually work. There are some breakpoints up here, though. I'll let this finish indexing and then I'll run it. Because Xcode loves to index. So I'm just going to verify a few little things with these areas. So we're calling area guaranteed for the first time from creating a dungeon Z. We've already created the dungeon. This is dungeon number one. It's a random dungeon. It's got 18 different rooms, so there's going to be 18 different areas it's creating. This is the first time it's created any single area, so it's got to go... wait, let's make sure one more breakpoint. We need to check one other thing. This. Okay, so let's step in. So there, I just created an array of area pointers, world areas. There's num z entries. It does compile. That's a good thing. Areas look like they created, okay. It did not, I should have, oh, okay, here's a huge bug. I need to mem set every single one of these to null. That would have been bad, because I had no indication that any of them were actually null. So, mem set, should I mem set or should I loop over them all? I should probably loop over them all for all IDs. World.areas I minus one equals null. Okay, that's a lot better. Memset, be faster. Well, The reason I didn't do mem set right there is because I wanted to be kind of pragmatic about it and test that this for loop is working. No constructor. No, I want to do this in this area guaranteed, so it delays creating the areas until then, because sometimes a world fails. So like it's generating the world, and it's like, oh, I couldn't generate that world. And so there's really no need to create the area as array until it's needed. So, okay, so we just created the areas array. It's, once again, it's got all this random memory. And let's see if we can go... Wait, it only created 50 of them? Or is it just only showing 50 of them? I think it's only showing 50 of them. So, but let's make sure that this first one creates null at the first end. It didn't. Oh, wait, yeah, it did. Zero is null. The next one. Okay, good. What is the sign between area and that? That's a pointer. So it's creating an array of pointers. This is creating a C array, a plain old, well, this is, a C++ style array. But anyways, it's basically a C array. That's an array of pointers. So that little pointer sign, that's what that is. So third element. Okay, this does appear to be working, so let's run to here. Right, C array located in a C++ way. Oh yeah, this syntax is the C++ style of a locating memory. I think underneath this, it doesn't use malloc. Salad Dongs would know. Okay, so it looks like it did. It didn't crash or anything when I just did that. That's good. But I still don't actually know that this is perfectly correct. I need to check this. What next? Auto create this array. So this is, what ID is this? What are we trying to create? Position 431. Oh, okay. Oh, this is, yeah, okay, so yeah, you can allocate an array of, an array of pointers. Okay, so the ID for that is 17205. We get the array pointer, it should be null. Oh, I guess I could check this by trying to get the very last area. I'll do that here in a second. I do want to see if this actually runs. So then we allocate a new area. This should construct it, invalidate its pause and stuff like that. So this A is now a pointer to an array. It's got everything set to zero. Its area pause should be -1, -1. Yep. And then that just sets the pointer. And then we validate it. I think that's working. Okay. Oh, it didn't work. Okay, I must have had some error in there. I was really hoping that would all work on the first try. But this is life. So... I did run into an exec bad access. What's the bad access? What's the problem? Oh, it's this very same area when it's trying to create the pattern for it. X0, Y0. Why is that? What is it actually crashing here? This is where it's trying to access area pause? This, oh, it's probably this area. No, it's not. It can't be. The area is fine. It's got a perfectly fine. Everything looks good. This data is all. This all looks all right. Lightness. Yeah, everything's fine here in this area. Then we get in here and we call blocks raw clamped. This should be fine. And this is the very first area of them all. It's just failing. Which is kind of good. It's kind of good that there's some obvious bug here. Let me just stop and rerun and see if this just works the second time. Of course, it's not going to. Oh, wait, it's clearing? It failed. This time it failed the world. Oh, it's depending on how the standard library is implemented. Yeah. Huh. Interesting. Well, I'm kind of at a bug point right here. Damn. I was really hoping I could be like, yay, look, it all works. And look, it's so much faster. Well, it's not working. And it probably is faster once it's all said and done. But I'm going to have to take a break now. I'm tired as hell. So most of the refactoring's done, at least. The refactoring's all in place. There's just some little gotcha somewhere, something probably obvious. Or I'm like, I looped too far, I didn't loop far enough, something like that. Oh, apparently they all implement it with malloc. Huh. You know my pain, right? Right? All right, guys. Well, sorry it's going to end like this, but I'm already way past my time for today's stream. So I do appreciate you guys chatting with me along the way, though. And yeah, hopefully by tomorrow this will all be faster. So cheers. Thanks a lot for watching, and I appreciate it. And we'll see you next time.